and welcome. This is a chat with the professional, the show that has been designed to x-ray the activities of professional individuals and corporate bodies. My name, as always, Martin Subu, and I'm sure glad to be with you. Today on the show, we are going to be taking a look at the country called Nigeria. And we've paid a visit to one of Nigeria's most respected elder statesmen, someone who has been in government for many years, but refuses to answer a politician. For the simple fact, perhaps, politicians have this image of inconsistency. But as far as I am concerned, he's still one, though not partisan. Today we are going to be listening to his counsel on what he thinks about the country called Nigeria, what the military rulership in this country did against what the current democratic dispensation is offering Nigerians. We shall be listening to him in a moment. Don't go anywhere. We will take a short break and we'll be back. Alright, viewers, you're still watching the show, Chat to the Professional. And like I mentioned to you, today we are having a great man, someone that needs no introduction, an elder statesman. He's held several public offices in Nigeria, and at above 75, he's still waxing very strong. So it's my privilege and honor to bring on set today on the show, Chief Alex Akinyele. You're welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you very much. You're welcome too to my house.
Thank you. I'd like you to share some of your experiences as a public office holder, particularly under a dispensation that ordinarily was considered not to be too popular, given the fact that it was a military regime. And then here we are in a democracy, and things seem not to have been any better than they were, under the. As a matter of fact, some argue that things seem to have been better under the military dispensation. So what's your thoughts on that, comparing the time you were in government under the military regime and what's going on now?
I thank you very much for your question. When we were there, at the time we were there, people felt that we were notorious, people felt that things could be better, people felt that we were not democratic. And they criticized very viciously whatever we did. But I knew that it was because Nigerians have a concept that military regime is not good. So if it's an angel that is there, the angel is not good. But I can actually understand that most of the people who were crying that things were not good are still crying today, which meant that they were blinded when General Abagida was there.
Yeah.
General Abagida was there, was doing his best, and those of us who knew that he was doing his best and who saw the difference between what he was doing and what the professional agitators were saying, knew that he was doing his best. I am happy that now we are in a democratic institution and the same people are saying they are not good. So you may ask, what is really good for them? But definitely, when we were there, we are privileged to know that it was a good government because we saw many of the people who were crying in the street that this government is bad. They came round in the night. Please, Minister, tell IBB, I don't believe in what they are saying. IBB is good. Tell him it's very good. That's part of the people. And then you go back to the president, Mr. President, so people say you are doing very well. And then he will say, if they say so, let them go to the street and say so. Why do they come to your house to tell you it is good? And they go to the street to say it's bad. Invariably, we are now talking about the animal called man.
Yeah.
Some people are now crying that if he were around, if IBB were there, there would be no Boko Haram. If somebody came here about a few days ago to say, Chief Akinyele, you people serve the best government in this country. Do you think that General Obasanjo will be on the stage while these Boko Haram people are doing what they are doing? He said they won't take it. He said Boko Haram will not last a week under Babangida. It will not last a week under OBJ. I said, thank you very much. Go to the street and say it.
Say that.
There are so many things I saw which members of the public didn't see. And I tried to make them see it through my eyes. Some accepted, some didn't accept. But today, in some of these interviews and what happened, they said Babangida is the best military man we ever had in this country. And that's a statement of fact. There was something about IBB. All the great things he did in this country, he didn't allow them to bear his name. He did well, he did excellently, but nothing in his name. For instance, I was asking him, why is the Tall Mainland Bridge not IBB Bridge? Because some of these governors, they built a poultry, some, and so on and so forth. But you see, he did his best in the interest of the nation and not in the interest of his name. He did it and then he withdrew to go and do another one. Mm-hmm. And those of us who were with him, especially somebody like me in information, I was very proud of him. Some of my friends called me Babangida's parrot.
I'm glad with this background information. As an individual, yes, military government anywhere may not be popular. We are not in any way advocating a return of military rule in Nigeria or any part of the world. My concern as an individual is the issue of sycophants, which has always been the case. If you ask me, the major problem of leadership in this country is that of sycophants. You just cited an instance where people will come to your house and tell you you're doing very well. And then they go behind the same set of people who come to you are the same set of people who go out there and say different things. And unfortunately for many Nigerians, for as long as there is money getting into their personal pockets, you are fantastic in your presence.
Yeah.
And so it's a very big problem. So I personally do not think that it's so much of whether it's military or civil rule that is in place. It's about leadership by example. And you just cited an instance where IBB, for instance, built some monuments that never bore his name. And today we have governors and other political office holders spending taxpayers' money to advertise themselves rather than projecting what will be beneficial to the people. So what would the youth be driving from you?
Thank you very much for that question. Thinking or talking about the youth and leadership, the youth of this country have lost the sense of direction. As much as possible, they want leaders. And most of the time they say this is their role model. But the same youth are the people used by politicians to say what they don't even believe.
I agree with you.
So the question is, where are we going? I could remember about 9 or 10 months ago, the youths in Ondo State gave me a title, an award. Great leader, role model, this and that. And I thank them very profusely. But I examined them. I came to understand that, like their fathers and their forefathers, they are sycophants. How do we get rid of this in our society? Like we saw in one of these states the other time.
Yeah.
It was a question of National Association of Nigerian Students.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the executives were in the payroll of some executives in River State. So, the situation, whichever way the pendulum swings, there seems to be no hope. There will be hope when we actually have the leadership that will do what is right for the nation, not what is right for them. Mm-hmm. Incidentally, today in Nigeria, we have a democratic government, but the way our president is going to go this way, It goes this way. It's like a reed on the sea. It moves wherever the wind moves. Mm-hmm. And who are responsible? We, the people. You see, it is when we have a Nigerian leader who will, like Caesar say, what affects us ourselves shall be last out. Caesar was about to be assassinated. Artemidorus came to warn him. Caesar, I have a letter. What kind of letter do you have? And that dreamer came. Caesar, I have a letter. What kind of letter do you have? The letter I have is for you only, not for any other person. That which concerns us ourselves shall be last out. And in this country, what concerns our leaders shall always be first served. Well, we can change it and become another Caesar. We shall have a better country. That's where I see it.
Do you think we are where we should, as far as broadcasting in particular is concerned, and then information in general?
Thank you for your question. You see, if we think of where we are today, we should thank God. I'm saying so because, you see, when you watch AIT and NTA, you see their mode of dishing out information. Mm-hmm. And you go to channels, mm-hmm. and you go to Continental. Mm-hmm. You see, you will see that you are hearing the whole breadth, length and breadth of what is happening in the country. If it were to be NTA alone, you would just be hearing only one side, and that one side, which helps government, which is good for government. So I feel we are better off because of that liberalization.
Okay.
Yes.
Right, thank you very much, sir. Also looking at information, under your regime, do you want to compare, like you said, those days it was just one side of the coin coming from the government or state stations. And then we also have today, under a democratic dispensation, situations where reporters are equally abused by democratically elected government. Why do we still witness abuse of responsibilities?
Thank you very much. I happened to have had the privilege of going around the world to see how information people play their role in their countries. There was a time General Babangida asked me to go to General Rawlings to seek his support in the choice of General Obasanjo as the Secretary General of the United Nations. When I got there, when we were talking, General Rawlings said, "Well, Mr. Minister, how do you cope with those your lawless journalists?" I said, in what country, sir? "In your Nigeria." I said, "Ah, Your Excellency, if you come to Nigeria and you see the way our journalists act, they behave, they do their work, you will admire them. You will admire them." The reason being that the Nigerian journalist is trained, he's educated, he's experienced, and at the same time, he knows his onions. He knows that if he's arrested today, tomorrow he'll be released. So he can do his job very well. Okay. I know occasionally there are some excesses, but those excesses bear on personal relationships.
Yeah.
I've seen some journalists who fall out with some governors or some ministers and they fight dirty. That is human. It is not the institution.
Yeah.
That is the way I see it.
Happens all over the world.
All over the world. When I was information minister, I had a lot of row with the journalists on principle. And when I felt that I was wrong, I would always say, "I am very sorry." Or when we had a very bad incident playing, I would tell them, "Gentlemen and ladies, I know there are no ladies among you. Gentlemen, you call yourselves. This incident is not good for the image of the country. So let us close our eyes to it. And so far you tell them the truth, they will bury it for you." Mm-hmm. But when you try to fool them, they will show you the bottom part of the story.
All right, sir. It's been my pleasure so far interacting with you, an elder statesman, Chief Alex Akinyele, a man who needs no introduction in Nigerian politics, even though he has refused to answer a politician, for those who know him well. But as far as I'm concerned, like one professor, the first professor of marketing in West Africa will always say, everything we do is marketing. And I also believe that everything we do on a daily basis is politics. Whether it's partisan, that's a different ballgame. But at this point, we must take a break. Don't go anywhere. We will be back. Welcome back. You're still watching The Show Chat to the Professional. And my guest today, an elder statesman, a man that needs no introduction in Nigerian politics. He's been a one-time Minister of Information. He also headed the Ministry of Sports. At some point also, he was the head of National Sports Commission. He was also the chief image maker of the Nigerian Customs. And of course, the National Reconciliation Commission. Chief Alex Akinyele, of course, has tried to give us an overview of what happened during the administration of particularly President Babangida, Ibrahim Babangida, the then military head of state, and then try to compare it with what is happening now. I'm going to narrow this discussion down to infrastructural development as it is today, in comparison with what you had under the military administration, and of course, taking into account the revenue stream of, you know, both governments, the military government, and what we have now under the civil rule.
For the past 6, 7, 8, 9 days, no electricity supply. And yet, this morning, they brought in our bill for electricity. How can we have development when there is no electricity? Well, everybody needs it, but nobody gets it. And we are paying for it.
Should we pay for what we are not using?
But that is the question. And we dare not fail to pay. We still pay. I read a piece of news sometime last week where they say Nigeria is the greatest...
the largest economy in Africa.
In Africa. We're deceiving ourselves. I don't believe in it. How can we be when we have no electricity? Now, you are talking about roads. Yes, the road is very good in January. After the first rain in the year, the road becomes something else. Mm-hmm. We're deceiving ourselves. There is no infrastructure to sustain the economy of this country. How could our Minister for Finance and Chief of the Economy in Nigeria say we are the best, when she knows deep down in her mind that from where she came in from the World Bank, there is never a country under that which will not have electricity 24 hours per day? By not being fair to her conscience, she's not fair to Nigeria. Call it what it is and let's make amends. Okay. The only person who is rearing his head above all these things we are talking is our governor in Lagos State, Babatunde Raji Fashola. Since he bought his light bus and all this, he has been functioning. And children, people, they are moving better and all the rest of it. That is where infrastructure works. The other time he wanted to give all of us light, they stopped him because it's going to affect their own general image. Infrastructure-wise, Nigeria is very poor. We're not well-manned at all. The roads are good when the governor is visiting. The roads are good when the president is visiting.
Your answer points to a direction that is so critical, and that's the issue of power. You just mentioned the attempt by Lagos State government to give power to the citizens. Don't you think that this is also an issue, you know, the issue of over-centralization of policies in this country, i.e. the police, even the power, because you can generate, but you don't have the power to distribute. And that becomes an issue. Lagos State is, I don't think, is an isolated case. I also know of River State that has equally cried out a number of times that, look, we're able to generate enough for the state, but we cannot distribute. So what do you think? What do you think could be done in that direction?
What could be done in that direction is to beg those who are in charge of giving the yes to people to think more of the nation. The other day they said that power holding something was going up. We said, oh, they divided all the loot among themselves, and ever since, light went off. What else? I think this over centralization will kill Nigeria. Because there is a limit to human endurance. After some time, all of us at once will just say, no, no more, we are fed up. There is a limit to human endurance. You see, when you came in this morning, I was a very sad man. Then my boy Goodman came to say, hey, what's your problem? He said, they have brought NEPA bill. I said, they brought NEPA bill. They do slap whoever brought it. He said, no. They do tell the person who brought it out, for 7 days, there is no light in this house. You know what? I think our problem is as the tortoise told us in one of his stories. Can I tell you the story?
Go ahead.
All the animals, they assemble themselves. Let us tell ourselves the problems of our children. Mm-hmm. The elephant said his own. The problem of my child is worse than that. All the animals said what was their problem. And tortoises continue to say no. Then he said, Mr. Tortoise, what is the problem of your own children? He said, my children have no sense of shame. So they will do anything without feeling it. That is our big problem in this country. There is no sense of shame. Until we have the sense of shame, that is, have integrity, things will not go well in this country. Let us give to Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what is God. That is the nation first. Let's give the nation first. If all our leaders will give to God what is God and give to the nation what is the nation, we shall be much better than where we are now. The leaders are very, very selfish. They are not like Caesar. And they are gluttonous. They are never they are not satisfied. The other time there was a probe in this country where a man built 99 houses. Does he hear from anywhere that when you are going to heaven or you are going to hell, you have to give this to the devil or give this to God? No. I had a piece of story some time ago that the Redeemed Christian Church of Christ is going to build a 4 kilometers by 4 kilometers auditorium. I say, ha, is God relocating to Nigeria? You see? Don't smile, don't laugh. It's the time for us to cry for this country.
You know, one could be smiling or laughing, but deep down he's crying.
Suffering or smiling?
Yes, that's what Fela called it.
Fela, rest in peace.
What you're saying, I'm actually laughing because as an elder, we all know that is generally accepted that the older generation actually failed this nation. Not in totality.
And I agree with you.
Yes. So to that extent, when it comes from an elder statesman like you, it makes me laugh. As a young man, I know the challenge I face. We've been running this show for 14 years now. The corporate organizations wouldn't put down their money on this show. You know why?
No.
Because we are saying it as it is. Because it is not an entertainment show. So that's why when you were talking, I was laughing that we don't have a sense of shame. That's the major problem. How do we begin to go back to those days when I was much younger? I remembered when if you had a rich man stop on the road and dash you money or give you money, you run. And you run back home to tell your parents, I saw this man. Perhaps he's someone you know. But you don't know the source of his wealth. And then you run back and say, can you imagine that man gave me money? Did you collect? No. Oh, good child.
Yeah, good child.
Not anymore. No. That level of moral decadence that has got us to the point where there is no shame any longer is the issue, the crux of the matter.
It is.
How do we get out of it?
I used to say that a man, to prove that he's really popular, he's strong, he's powerful in this country, it will depend on how many laws he can break scot-free. Mm-hmm. Go scot-free.
Yeah.
The president stubbornly wants to go a fifth time. And Boko Haram are there conscientiously reducing the population of Nigeria. And there's nobody strong enough to stop them. The president came out to say, yes, ladies and gentlemen of this country, don't say I'm foolish. I'm not foolish. I know those members in my government who are for Boko Haram. I know them. They're in my government. Let us ask him, when he knew them, what did he do to them? Is he himself not encouraging them? At the time you become the president of Federal Republic of Nigeria, you are not to be afraid of anybody, anything, any institution. Why did he keep quiet? He has to keep quiet because of his personal interest in the presidency in 2015.
We leave it at that for now. Somehow, someday, we'll be able to get back to this elder statesman to perhaps get another counsel from him on how best this nation could be moved forward. Chief Akinyele, it's been my pleasure chatting with you.
I thank you very much for
the privilege
of giving me the opportunity to air my views to the world in Nigeria here.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. God bless you.
All right. I'm afraid as the much time would permit on the show today, a chat with the professional. It's been a wonderful moment, a refreshing one at that. If you listen carefully to Chief Akinyele, you will understand that Nigeria is not as bad as people think. It's just a question of our getting it right where it matters the most. And what we are saying is that if we could join hands together and reawaken that consciousness in our psyche that when you do right, you are honored, and when you do wrong, you are disgraced. If we can go back to that era, of course, I'm sure Nigeria will not just be the greatest economy in Africa, but of course the entire world. We've got the potentials, we have the human resources, we have the material resources, and we've got all it takes to be the best in all aspects. Till next week when I come your way, I will keep urging you, the practicing professionals, to remain resolute to follow the ethics of your profession. And for the younger ones, keep drawing inspiration from these core professionals that we feature on a weekly basis to be a better person. And do not lose hope on Nigeria, because the future rests squarely on your achievement in years to come. I'm Martin Sobusa, stay blessed now, and I will see you again.